Good morning, good morning, good morning. How are y'all? Welcome to the Burns Memorial Church of God in Christ. We just want to thank y'all for tuning in this morning, and we just thank God for you. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you, we praise you, we magnify your name, we lift you up this morning, Lord. We give you all the glory. And Lord, as we are about to impart your word, we ask that you send a word. Let it do what you have purposed it to do. I decrease, you increase. Your word will not return void, just as you say. In Jesus' name, amen. And I always like to start out with, you know, one of my old songs. Even though I'm not a songster, but bear with my singing to the glory of God. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other. Jesus is the way. If you have some questions in the corner of your mind, traces of discouragement, peace you cannot find. Depressions from the past seem to haunt you every day. But this one thing I do know, Jesus is the way. One more time. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other. Jesus is the way. How many know that Jesus is the answer? Jesus is the reason for the season. Jesus is the answer. Jesus is everything. Amen, amen. I just hoped that this viewing, this filming, finds you well. And I'm believing that God is doing great things even in the midst of this pandemic. Amen, amen. Let's get on into the Word of God. As you see, my subject this morning is heavy weight. Heavy weight. Amen. 2 Corinthians 12 and 7. I want to come from there. And it reads, "And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelation, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness." We've been talking on a subject, you know, for a couple of the last two, the Bible study and Sunday before that. And my subject was, but if not. And I was telling the people of God that we have to get to the place where we have a resolve in our faith that whether it goes good or it goes bad for us, we still trust God and hold on and believe that he's going to bring us through the valleys and over all the stuff that, you know, comes in our way. Paul, y'all know Brother Paul, he's given credit to have written a lot of the New Testament. And if he didn't write it, he influenced it. But that man, that educated preacher, that very staunch man, and one that, you know, when he believed something, he died for it. He held on to it. He was being used by God. The Bible says that even his cloak, his clothes were healing folks, and he would go forth and just work the things of God and preach under such an anointing and teach under such an anointing. And he was, you know, he had a resolve to die for the things of God. This man who spoke several languages, he was a Hebrew of Hebrew. He was one that sat under the feet of great teachers and took the time to learn the law and learn the word of God. One that had an extraordinary experience with God, an encounter with God on the road to Damascus, where he was blinded and he heard God call him up higher to a higher calling and a higher understanding. Here he is telling the people of God, telling the Corinthian church, he says, I was given a thorn in the flesh. He said, I asked God three times to take this issue away from me. Take it away from me, Lord, because it seems like it's a hindrance. It seems like it's a shortcoming that is impeding my ministry. He said, take it away. And when he finally got an answer from God, because remember, he sought God three times. He went before the Lord. And when he finally got an answer, the answer that came wasn't what he expected. He expected to be delivered. He expected to be healed. But the answer that came was, my grace is sufficient for you, brother. Just walk in my grace. And I began to think about that thing, because a lot of us are trying to pray our issues away, pray our idiosyncrasies away, pray our uniqueness away, pray the thing that we, you know, we're so focused on the hindrances, on the issues, to we're not getting done what we're supposed to do. Jesus said, occupy till I come. So we're supposed to be doing what God has called us to do, no matter what state we're in, until Jesus comes, until deliverance comes, until our breakthrough comes. But we got to be like the three Hebrew boys. But if it don't come, I'm going to continue to do. I'm going to work with my issues. And I noticed that a lot of people, haters, they always focus on other people's shortcomings. They always focus on their down settings and their issues, and don't even realize that those issues might be the thing that walk you into your greatness, might be the thing that keep you in your greatness. See, a lot of people can get there, but their character won't keep them there. And it is worse to get there and fall than to never get there at all. People don't even realize that. I don't want to become a big man and then be broke again. Because after I tasted those billions and the lifestyle that can bring, can you imagine that, to go back to a pauper's lifestyle? I'd rather stay a pauper and never not know the goodness of $1 billion. Do you understand what I'm saying? So we get to a place, but our character can't keep us there. And this is the reason why God allows certain things. See, God doesn't call perfect people. God doesn't call, we look at people and we think like Superman, that they perfect. But notice, even Superman had his kryptonite. Everybody has an issue, has something that will keep them, you know, at a certain level if they allow it. God allows these things to keep us grounded. This is what Paul says. He said, unless I be lifted, unless I get conceited, unless I get the big head, God has allowed me. And see, the thing is, he sought God for his deliverance of whatever that issue was. But in his seeking God, he realized why God allowed him to have the issue. Now, when I look in the Word of God, I see that the people that God used the most had the biggest issues. Like Jephthah. Jephthah was a gangster and a criminal. He was a judge in the Bible. And God used him, against the enemy. When we think about Peter, Peter was a leapster. He didn't think before he acted. He would jump out. You know, he would just jump right out the boat. Look, me, I'm coming. He the first one to jump into things. He denied Christ. First one to deny Christ. But then look how God used him to win more souls with one sermon in an instant. Do you see what I'm saying? And when I think about David, come on, you know Brother David. David had many issues. He loved them women. He loved them ladies. Okay? And he would get stuck in that issue, which would cause stuff that's just generational, passed on where his son committed rape and incest, and then the other son did this, did that. All his issues, you know, they brought a lot of stuff. But look how God used him. Look how much he was used by God in the Bible. Oh, y'all know who's that man, that Samson. Samson had issues. He know another one loved them ladies that weren't so wholesome or so virtuous. He loved the women of the night. But that same issue God used to destroy so many enemies in one instant. Do you understand? Because of this issue. See, you got to understand something. We're running away from our issues. We're sitting there. You got people sitting up for years. No God called them to preach. No God called them to go forth. And then they turn around. But I got to get this right. I got to get this part right. I gotta get that right. And then you sit there 20, 30 years, and you still ain't got it right. And you don't even realize that it was never for you to get right. It was for you to get going and do what God said to do. And while you go, he's going to work that thing out. Grace is going to come. So you got to understand what God's grace is. God's grace is his heavyweight presence, his glory, his presence. When you enter into his grace, you operate under the presence of God. So how do I get to the grace of God? By allowing my weaknesses. When I am weak, he is strong. By allowing them to be on the forefront and stop hiding it from people. See, I can't stand them preachers that are preach and act like they just so perfect. And won't allow the people to know that they're just a man or they're just a woman. Don't allow them to know, like, I like Jeremiah. Jeremiah told God, I'm just a child. Lord, do you see I'm just a child? You know, and God said, don't call yourself a child because I did this for you and I did that for you. Yeah, he had the issue of being immature. He had the issue of being young. But God told him to go forth anyway because I made you an offense city. I'm with you. Do you understand? See, I found this out. And that's when I start embracing my issues and not running from them. That's when I start letting you know, yeah, that's me. I like that movie, 8 Mile, with Eminem. How he beat the guy in that little rap game. You know, he turned around and said, you know, yeah, I know I'm white trash. I know I'm trailer. You know, trash or whatever. I know I'm this. I know I'm that. No. Now what you got to say? See, when you allow your issues to be on the forefront and don't hide them, you can do more for God because the enemy has nothing that he can use. The enemy can't tell what you haven't already told. We need to stop trying to walk in perfection and walk in the presence of God. Yea, do I walk through the valley of shadow of death. Thou art with me. His presence, he's with me. His glory, my grace is sufficient for you. Stop trying to just do it all yourself because you can't do it. Anything that God has given you is bigger than you. So if it's bigger than you, then it ain't you that are doing it. But greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Greater is the one that has empowered me. Do you understand? We have to get out of laboring in our minds on our proclivities and start focusing on God's strength, his strength. When I am weak, he is strong. I remember Prophet Ezekiel. Ezekiel prophesied about some waters, and he said as he walked through the waters, it was ankle deep. He was being led by the Lord. He was in the presence of God. I want you to get this. It's in Ezekiel 47. He says, as I walked, it came to the ankle. Then I walked further, it was to the knees. Then I walked further, it was to the waist. Then I walked further, and I couldn't touch the ground. You know, so what that waters represented was he was walking in the presence of God And he went deeper and deeper and deeper in God's presence till it no longer was he in control. He couldn't even walk no more. He was being carried by waters. Do you see where I'm going with that? He was being carried by the presence of God. It led him to a place where he got past himself. There it is, the key right there. When we can get beyond ourselves, that's when we can do our greatest work. When we can get outside of ourselves. We're so stuck in the prisons of woe is me, and I got this issue and this, that, and I'm not as pretty as this person. I'm not as skinny as this person. I'm not as tall as this person. I don't have the articulability, I made that word up, as this person. Do you understand? I can't sing like this person. People be laughing about my singing every time I get on. And you know what I'm saying? Because I found that out. I see some of the greatest singers, they ain't doing nothing with their gift. Souls are being won with my bad singing. Because I'm willing to sing. Did y'all get that? My preaching might not be the greatest. I know it ain't the worst. But it might not be the greatest. But I'm willing to preach. All you got to do is go ahead and be yourself. Get beyond yourself and let God take control. You can tell when a preacher is teaching and preaching under the anointing or when it's them. They try to use their gifts, but I don't want to flow in the gifts. I want to flow in the anointing because it's the anointing that destroys the yokes, that break hearts for God, that have folks surrender and say, yes, Lord. So I don't worry about what anybody thinks about me. If you don't think I'm pretty enough, if you don't think I'm safe enough, it don't matter. What God is doing with me is what matters. Come on, somebody. I'm hoping somebody get this because you got to embrace that. My grace is sufficient. Grace is his heavyweight presence. Ezekiel walked till he got out of the place of control. He was no longer in control. And then he was brought back to the shore. If you read that scripture, he was brought back to observe and then to ask questions. And he said, well, those waters that was carrying me, what is that? And the Lord told him, that's the Holy Spirit. It represented the waters, the living waters that flow from the throne of God, from the presence of God, being in his presence. The Holy Spirit is what does the job, is what destroys the yoke. Do you understand? Get filled with the Spirit, people. And all your issues will not matter. I remember when Jesus first began his ministry, he turned around and saw some fishermen in the boat. And he went up to them, he said, listen, have you caught anything? Because they had been toiling all night trying to fish. And they were just washing their nets now, giving up. He said, have you caught anything? He said, well, listen, launch out into the deep. And they looked at him like, listen, we're fishermen. You preaching. You gonna tell us to go deeper? And there ain't nothing out there. We've been out there. He said, launch out. And when they launched out, the Bible said they caught more fish in one moment than they probably did their whole career because the nets began to break. They began to get scared. Can you imagine getting blessed so good that now you're scared because the blessings is coming so fast? Oh, see, I'm feeling that because that's what the Lord is doing in my life now. He's blessing and blessing and blessing. And it'll bring on some fear if you're in the flesh. Because you ain't never been blessed like that. I just wanted to interject that. Because that blessing right there, man. Oh, that's a blessing. But he told him, launch out into the deep. What he was telling him was, go past where you've ever been. And you get your blessing. So he was saying, get past your skill of being fishermen. Your knowledge of being fishermen. Get past what you have already done and what you've already understand. Get some revelation. And revelation only comes in the presence of God. True revelation from God. All that philosophy and all this stuff people come up with, that ain't from God. You ain't deep when you think you deep. You deep when God reveals. He gives you that, ooh, that rhema word straight from heaven. That's when you're deep. Get past yourself. Launch out into a place, a deep place, a place that you're not familiar with. Because, see, it's only in this place that faith kicks in, people. Do you not understand? You think you have faith walking in an area that's familiar to you. Faith never goes by the familiar roadway. Faith always takes you into uncharted territory. Faith always takes you into the place of the deep, takes you into darkness, and it's the light in the midst of darkness. Faith always takes you into impossibility, because possibility is in the realm of flesh. Do you not understand? Faith always takes you outside of yourself. It will always lead you to another place. So then faith is where I want to be, because that's the only way I can please God. So faith takes me into the presence of God. Do you not know how important the presence of God is, people of God? Do you not know how important it is? David saw that the Ark of the Covenant was in the house of Obed, and saw how anointed his house was to have the presence of God in his house. And David was like, I got to get it to us, to the kingdom. I got to get this presence. He risked his life and his people's life to get that ark back, because he knew if I have the presence of God with me, oh my goodness, no matter what I'm in, no matter what situation, no matter what danger I'm in, the three Hebrew boys knew the same thing. You understand? David coined a song. He said, if I make my bed in hell, thou art there. If I got his presence, you there. I can make my bed in hell. I can be in hell as long as I got God's presence. Do you understand? In other words, you got people that consider themselves in heaven without God's presence. And David's saying, I'm in a better place in hell with God's presence. Because God can turn hell into something else. God can turn hell into heaven for me when I got his presence. Do you not know that people think hell is such a terrible place because of heat and fire, when they don't realize that hell is a terrible place because the absence of the heavyweight presence of God there? Jesus was on the cross and he said, I thirst. And people thought that he was talking about he needed some water. When he was pierced in his side, water flowed from him. He wasn't talking about that. He was saying, I thirst, because he took on the sins of the world. And for the first time, he felt a separation from him and the Father. Come on, somebody. And that brought about a thirst. That's that same thirst in hell when that rich man opened up his eyes and he saw Abraham on the other side, and he said, listen, let Lazarus dip his finger in some water and cool my tongue. What he was saying was, anybody got a word? There's no word in here. Well, I get excited when I start talking about that. There's no word in here. That word is what keeps me from being thirsty. That word is what keeps me satisfied. David said, that word that I hid in my heart. Come on, somebody. I won't walk around thirsty. You ever see thirsty people? They're not satisfied because they don't have that word in them. You don't have to have a mate, or you can be lonely with that word and be satisfied, like John on the Isle of Patmos. He was exiled by himself. And that word came and he began to see things that nobody else saw. He began to describe it and wrote the book of Revelations. Oh, somebody, I hope you got that word today. I'm closing. But God's heavyweight presence is what you want. Embrace your idiosyncrasies. Embrace your infallibleness. Embrace your issues. I didn't say flow in your issues. I said embrace them. Accept them and let God's grace allow you to manage them and to do what he has called you to do. People of God, people of God, hear the word of the Lord, receive the word of the Lord. If you do not know God and Jesus Christ in salvation, the Bible said the word is nigh thee, even in your mouth, that if you confess Jesus, believe in your heart that he died for you and rose again for you, you're saved. So give your life to the Lord right now. And as soon as you give your life to the Lord, receive the Holy Spirit. Be endued with power in Jesus' name. I want to thank all of those. And if you've given your life to the Lord, I'd like you to, you know, DM me. You know, let me know. Because I like to know that God's word coming forth from, you know, Burns Memorial Church, me, you know, is doing something. Also, I thank God for all those that are giving and supporting our ministry in the midst of this pandemic. I know how hard it must be to give in unsure times like this. But it's times like this that you sow and receive miracles. I wish I could tell everything that God is doing for me and my family and our church family, but he's doing great things. And I'm telling you, in the midst of all of this mess, God is protecting. He's doing. It's not always money that he gives back. Y'all think about it. In this moment, you want God to keep you from dying from this pandemic. Because so many people are dying. So if he do nothing else but protect you and cover you, receive that blessing. Your sowing brings about miracles, brings about stuff for you. Give and it shall be given. All right, you see our Cash App? There. See us Monday night, my wife and I. We're going to be on with a couple, another couple, anointed couple, pastor and his wife. And we're going to, it's called Marriage Mondays at 7 p.m. See us. Come tune in and be blessed because we're going to be talking to singles and married folks. All right? Also, Tuesdays, my wife gets on. Catch her. Thursdays, Bible study at 8 p.m. Eastern. Catch us. Amen. God bless y'all and y'all have a wonderful day, and tell the devil he's a liar. Amen.